First, thank you for coming to my presentation of my FIP. And in my FIP, I'm going to build a generative model to generate some view image. But I think this topic is a bit general, and so I just restrict my discussion in the first semester, just focus on a particular type of generative network, which I have to do some investigation on it. And this is the form of my presentation today, and basically this whole part, I will just briefly introduce the background information about the generative network and what is the generative adversarial network, and then talk about some existing work that is built on top of the generative network, and talk about some of my work, and the future work will be something that I will do in the this semester. Yes? Maybe let's start. And first of all, what is a generative model in the field of computer vision? And we want to teach the computer how to draw some image that look real. This seems quite obvious. But how can we do this job? And the first way we can do is just by copy and paste. Here, copy and paste, I mean that is an unparametric model that has a large database of images, and it can detect the texture of some of the target image and replace the texture with some of the pilot image in the database. And this is something that we do in the early age of the generative model. And then we have something that is new that is more referable. This is the parametric model, and we want to learn some model to help us to learn more about the feature of an image. And then we talk more. And actually, you may find that it's quite similar as the discriminative model that we may be familiar with, such as the classification task, and we want to learn the feature of an image and do some classification on it. But there is some fundamental difference between a generative model and a discriminative model. And is that for discriminative model, we are doing something like an abstraction, while in the generative model case, we are doing something like a realization. In other words, we are reducing, for discriminative model, we are reducing the dimension of the image feature to some sort of class label, and we in generative model, given some feature, image feature, we want to generate a real image. Actually, the dimension of the image feature is greatly increased. And since, as you may know, that for discriminative model in recent year, it's quite popular to use some neural network-based method to do the classification task. And one of the most commonly used architecture is the convolution neural network, it's the CNN. And a quite naive question is that, can we just simply reverse the current discriminative model for a generative model, since we have extracted some feature of a of an image by some discriminative model? Can we just do the other way around, input in some image feature and generate back a real image? And the answer is not that obvious, since the discriminative function learned in CNN is actually not invertible mathematically. We are actually reducing the dimension, which is quite obvious. But is there any other way for us to leverage the advantages of CNN in building a generative network? And one way is the generative adversarial network, and here I will call it GAN in short. And what is a generative adversarial network? Indeed, the main idea is come from game theory. And first, talk about something, the advantages of this kind of network. Comparing to other existing generative models, it requires no inference or Markov change in the process, so that it's easier for us to learn by simple gradient descent, and yes, that's why it's also easy to be modeled by a CNN architecture. And what is the main idea in the generative adversarial network? This idea is quite simple. And consider there is two pairs who are competing with each other. And one pair is called the generator, instead of calling it G, and another pair is a discriminator, I call it D. And what are their objective? For the G is to generate some fake image to fool D. And D is to determine whether an image is generated by G or not. And the idea is quite simple. And in other words, they are playing a game where D wants to maximize the probability of making a correct decision, while G wants to minimize the probability that D successfully identifies his fake image. And note that they are taking the action simultaneously, and G will take some random vector as an input to generate a different image. And it's proved theoretically that the outcome is the G fully recover the distribution of the real images, while D has a half chance of guessing whether it's a fake image or not. And I think it's quite intuitive. And I think one good analogy is that consider G is the criminal and D is the police. And the criminal wants to make some fake currency, and the police is to identify whether it's the real or not. And if the criminal has unlimited amount of resources, he must have the way to generate a fully generate the same currency as the real one. So it's moderate this kind of situation. And but there are some limitations in this GAN. And the first one is that it's quite hard to coordinate the discriminator and the generator during the training. And I will illustrate this later more. And it's also vulnerable to overfitting, is that it may be the generator may learn how to remember the exact image as the training sample and just show the training sample to the discriminator so that it's meaningless. Yes. And the third problem is that we cannot have low control on the attributes of the generative image. For example, if we give the model some training data as the faces of different people, and we can't control the generator to generate a female or male by the original GAN architecture. So to address this kind of problem, someone has also built on top of this GAN and propose some new architecture to cater this kind of problems. And the first one to I want to introduce is the conditional GAN, which a quite obvious extension of the original GAN. It's just, as I mentioned before, since the generator will take a random vector as an input to generate a random image, instead of just pick the random vector randomly, completely, we can add some condition on it. For example, we can attach some label when we first draw the random vector, and then the discriminator can also get the label of the kind of image. And by this kind of conditional distribution of the random vector, and the generator can successfully control what they are going to generate. For example, in that work, they have successfully forced the generator to generate a digit from 0 to 9 as we specify by the input condition of the random vector. And a second variant of GAN is called the Laplacian GAN, which is aimed to produce a high resolution images with better quality. Since in the original work, they found that particularly the original GNN cannot generate a very high resolution image. It will look quite blurry when we try to increase the resolution of the image. And the idea is to, instead of drawing the whole images, and they separate the architecture into a few pairs of generator and discriminator, and each of them is competing with each other and learning how to upsample the image one by one. And the third one is called the deep convolutional GAN in solid point DCGAN, and in this architecture is kind of like an advancement in the implementation of the CNN in both discriminator and generator. And what they have done is, the first thing they done is introducing the branch normalization into different layer of the original architecture. And they have also replaced the pooling layer with straighter convolution. Is to, instead of teaching or hard coding the how the discriminator how to downsample the image, they prefer to let the discriminator and generator learn how to upsample and downsample more flexibly. And the first thing they do is just replace the rectifying unit in D with a leaky rectifying unit. And with this kind of adjustment, they find a much better quality in their generated image. And that's why it was used for some experiments in our work later. And this picture is from the original paper of DCGAN, and this shows the whole architecture of the DCGAN. At first, you can see that the input is a 100 dimension random vector, and then it goes through the first layer of convolution with fractional strike, and just that we can it's a fully connected layer to transform the input noise into a the first convolution layer, and then this is fed by generate the next layer by some strike convolution, and just repeat the procedure, and the last layer is to generate the real image, and just repeat this kind of architecture to generate the is the architecture used for the generator. And for the discriminator, actually every ring is quite symmetric, and here is the input, and we do the same thing to do the convolution and downsample it. And the last just is not a random vector, it's a cast label of whether it's a real image or a fake image. And well, let's go to talk what I have done in this semester. The first thing I have done is just reproducing the result of the DCGAN in two different data sets. The first data set is the church outdoor set, and the second is the tower data set in the LSM database. And here is some sample I have generated. And this is the first approach. After the first approach, the generator generates this kind of blurry image, and after some more iteration, we can generate the image more clearly, and this one. And after 15 iteration through the whole training set, and it can generate some image that looks more real, and you can see some image like a castle or like a church, something like that. And the visual quality is quite good. And but if you want to see more sample, I can show more after this presentation. I just give some example image here. And after doing the trying to reproduce the result, and I just start to have a deeper look in the design in the GAM and the DCGAM. And the first thing I'm interested in is whether the dimension of the input noise space will have influence to the training dynamic between the discriminator and the generator. Actually, I have read a few work, and all of them just stick with the Röntgenjahr dimension input noise. And actually, it do no theoretical effect to the theoretical optimum of the system. However, I suspect that it may or may not affect the training dynamics, and there may be a careful choice, more careful choice of input noise dimension. And but the problem come here is that how can we analyze the result of a generative model? Actually, it is quite unfortunate that there has been mentioned in many words that there is a lack of good performance metrics in many generative model, and one of the most common way that is kind of more reliable is the human subject experiment is to find some volunteer for them and to ask them whether the image is fake or not and do some statistic on that. And however, due to the time and resources constraint, I can't just find some volunteer for me to do this kind of experiment. And so that I just chose to look at the loss curve of both generator and discriminator during the training, as well as look at some generated samples to see if there is a significant effect in the visual quality of the generated image. And here it shows some sample of training curve. And the red curve here is the generator cost, while the blue curve here is the discriminator cost. And from this figure, we find this for the one-dimensional noise field not quite sensible, since obviously the input dimension is just too small and it's impossible for us to capture all features of the image. And it's so some kind of logical the loss trend like this. And for a 10 dimension input noise dimension, it shows that kind of loss distribution. And here is also other some example for 100 dimension input noise and for 1000 dimension input noise. And actually, here is some observation from the noise curve, and in all cases, the noise is quite fluctuating, especially for the generator. And for the discriminator, it decays quite steadily, yes. But it's a very obvious problem that the discriminator is learning much faster than the generator in the original architecture. And this may cause a problem since if the discriminator have very high confidence to reject the image generated by the generator, if the gradient falls to the generator will be very small according to the loss function defined. So it may cause some problems to the final quality of the generated image. And actually, can we do other things to analyze the quality of a generative model? And in one paper, they suggest a method is to do the interpolation of random vector. Actually, they claim that for a well-trained generator, if we do interpolation between two random vectors, we can see a smooth transition from one object to another. It's kind of a heuristic measurement of whether a generator is good or not. And in our work, we actually proposed a special kind of interpolation which potentially can produce a better visual effect. And the interpolation is not like this. Yes, here is the interpolation formula, and C1 and C2 is the random vector we want to interpolate. And here, C1 and C2 belongs to the noise distribution, and the noise distribution we chose is for each dimension is an independent normal variable with zero mean and one variance for the input noise distribution. And actually, I have theoretically proved that this is maybe more sensible to use this kind of interpolating formula instead of just simply linear interpolation. But the detailed proof is not included in this presentation. Yes. Here is some sample image of two kinds of interpolation. Actually, practically, they look quite similar. But I would say that the nonlinear version that I propose is slightly better, in the sense that if you see the intermediate interpolating vector, the generated image has more fine-grained feature. But I think the overall resolution is quite low, and you may not see clearly. And for example, you can see some kind of cloud here, while you can't see that kind of detailed feature in this linear interpolation. And the next thing I have proposed to do is just generalize the JN model into a multi-generator JN version. And this involves multiple generators instead of just one generator and one discriminator. And I have also proved the theoretical optimum of this kind of system is that the generator will work together to fully recover the distribution of the real image, while the discriminator is the same as before, just have one half chance to correctly identify whether the image is from G or not. And actually, this greatly increased the flexibility of the model design, since just we can introduce more generators to it. And we could produce some interesting results in this, actually. We can do it by some careful design of the update algorithm of the generator's parameters. And here we will show three simple algorithms that I have passed in this project. The first one is an uncompetitive model. It's actually just that the two generators, for all cases, I have just played with two generators. Yes. And in an uncompetitive model, actually the two generators just like didn't know the existence of one another. They just try their best to fool the discriminator, and yes, this is like this. And we find that the output image, each of them can recover the training data in distribution quite well. And the other version is called the loser take all, in the sense that we only update the generator with larger loss. It's just that it performs bad. If it performs worse than the other, we will update its parameter to make it perform better. And we find that the final result is quite similar. But actually, we are expecting that it may be a chance that the discriminator will learn much faster. This case, we are only updating one of the generator at a time, so that the discriminator may be learning faster than the generator. So it may cause a problem, but we have done some experiments and look at the sample images, and we find that that expected phenomenon didn't occur at all. And the last simple algorithm is that it's a winner take all algorithm. It is just like the previous one, we only update the one, but this time we only update the one with smaller cost. That is the one who do a better job to fool the discriminator. And by this kind of way, when we look at the intermediation and result, we find that it's soon that one of the generator keep losing, which is quite obvious. And because they, if it's performed worse, and they have a lower chance for it to learn more from the loss function. Yes? And finally, I want to talk about what I am going to do in the coming terms. And first thing is quite obvious is that we just want to further improve the visual quality of my of the generator in my project by maybe just adjusting the network architecture as well as tuning some of the hardware parameters to see if I can get a better visual result. And the later two is the more important thing I want to focus on, which is the first one. I want to design a more reliable and quantitative performance metric for the generated model. Since, as I have mentioned before, and in many other related work, there does not exist a good performance metric for the generated model. It makes me hard to tell whether I have do a great job or not. It's quite subjective for me to say that, oh, this sample is good, about some sample is bad. I think it's too subjective to say something like that. So in the current semester, it's a very faint direction for me to investigate more. And the other direction is, since I have this kind of generalized model for enfolding more generator, but I have just tried three very simple algorithms for the update. And I think there's more room for me to invent more complicated update algorithms for the standard version of GAN. And what are some brief direction or brief idea that I have thought about? For the first one, how to do a better job to determine whether a generative network is good or not, I will propose maybe we can use an external discriminative model to do the job. This does not quite make sense to use the discriminator in the GAN for this task of testing our model. Since the performance of the discriminator in GAN is highly dependent on the performance of the generator. If the generator keeps generating some very bad images, and the discriminator will also be quite weak. And we cannot use the discriminator in the GAN for a good performance matrix for whether the generator is good or not. So we may introduce an external discriminative model to classify whether the generated image is fake or not. And another direction which I mentioned is the update algorithm. This is the last slide. And for the update algorithm, I will want to introduce some more active compete between the generator and also, or more actively cooperate between them. Since as I have in this kind of model, they actually didn't actively compete with each other. I just do some routing of the noise to one of the generator depends on their performance. They are not actively competing with each other. So this is another direction for me to maybe improve the GAN. Yes, and I think this is the end of my presentation. Thank you.
So we just have a few comments because. Hey, Karen, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm sorry that I have another meeting right now, so I just have a very short comments about this presentation. I think generally this is a very good work, and given that this is undergraduate student and working on a cutting-edge research problem, so I think this is very great. My comment is that when we talk about this multiple generators, okay, do you have any theoretical priority when you have multiple generators that all the theoretical amounts you attend to when you have multiple generators?
Yes, I actually done the work in the thesis before. I have write some kind of proof to extend just adjusting the value function of the minimax scan in the original paper, and I can derive that it actually has some theoretical
guarantee. Especially when those generators are competing or cooperating with each other.
Yes, this hasn't been proved that if they are not competing with each other, they are doing their own job.
If they work independently, the analysis you hope, but yes, when they have some certain kind of interaction with each other, then you still have to need to rely on the future work to show.
Yes.
So I saw this is a page called the loss curve. How does the loss curve is defined?
Since I have simplified this and so many things in this, I have here is a well defined loss function for the generator and discriminator, and the value is the. Actually, I can show you the.
You mean you have the details in the thesis?
Yes.
Okay, I can go through it offhand. So at the beginning, you also mentioned you want to approach the problem through some kind of game theory.
Yes.
Is the game theory? You mean the relationship between the generator and the discriminator?
Yes, they're actually competing with each other, and what drives them to have the theoretical optimum is. Based on actually the the theoretical optimum. This one, the theoretical optimum actually is the Nash equilibrium of the game they are playing.
But I didn't see how it is reflected in the work. How the game theory will direct the generation of the images.
Actually, it's used for the theoretical analysis.
Not even for theoretical analysis.
Yes, it's that actually the generator and the loss function of the generator as well as the discriminator is trying to minimize in order to maximize the value of the game.
Okay, so every step they will do that kind of calculation.
Yes. In the thesis I have more detailed discussion
there. Maybe the next question is related to Dahua's question. You mentioned you want to use multiple GAN. So how the multiple GAN will work together? For example, for the same, they will, each of the GAN will responsible for a certain portion of the image, or they we work together to generate each pixel. How
they work
together?
Independently.
How they then merge the result in this final output?
They won't merge the result. Actually, after the training, I have two generators.
Okay.
And they will generate different kinds of image, maybe. It depends on the update level RAM I define.
So and the output is independent, you mean?
Yes, the output is independent.
I think Professor Zhang mentioned a very good point here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, then yes.
Yeah. So the way you, having the two generators cooperating is generating independent image and then the discriminator to decide whether it's true or false, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you can actually merge them together in terms of the pixels. like the generator one could generate a portion of pixels, then the other generator generates another portion of pixels to form a single image.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Because like different generators, they might specialize in different type of pixel generation.
Okay. So last question, you mentioned that the you want late the generator to have full knowledge about the distribution of real images.
Yes.
What the distribution means?
Distribution, but here it means that we consider the data have a grand shape distribution that given the input image space, for example, for a 3-channel 10 by 10 images,
mm-hmm.
It may be equivalent to a 3,000 out 3,000 the input space, and for in this space we can define a probability distribution in this space, and we can give the probability density of each point in this space, and this is what I call the
The distribution of certain patterns, you mean certain pixel or color groups?
No. Actually, every image in that input space is a point on the input space, and given a input space, actually, this may not be quite straight that it's 100% belong to that set of image.
Okay.
Even for human, there is some.
Okay, I see. So it's just kind of a small area, the distribution in a large data set, right?
Yes.
A large data set, there maybe a lot of images,
yes.
And you want to study the certain pixel or a group of pixels, the probability in a large of images. Okay, Kevin, I have no more questions, maybe you can continue.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. I don't have technical questions, just some comments to your slides. You need to use more images. Currently it's full of text, so yeah, people when they stay a long time will get bored. Okay.
Okay.
So you use more images and you need to show the equation of the GAN. That equation is important for people to understand how you optimize the GMD.
Mm.
Okay, show some illustration to illustrate the concept.
Mm.
That would be easier for people.
Mm. I suppose this is just a complimentary to my thesis report, so I just skip many technical details here.
No. You have to make your presentation understandable.
Mm, okay.
It has to be self-contained, okay?
Yes.
Okay, I think that's all for me. So thanks, Kwan.
Okay, sure. See you tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sure. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.